In this video, we will be looking at matrix calculus. This is a short video, the portions are slightly advanced. Once again, like with some portions of the probability series, you are free to skip this. I would still recommend that you go through this and see some of the relations. If you are not able to understand them or fully exploit them, that's fine, because we will be not using this for most part of the course. About 90% of the course can be done even without understanding this very well. So here's motivation for why we are looking at it. Please remember that as we had said in the first couple of weeks, machine learning basically requires you to take some input vector and change it into some output vector. Now, what will often happen during training is you will notice that the input vector that you have given doesn't quite give whatever required output vector you have, whatever you would require. So, for example, you know, if your output changes with respect to some set of parameters that you have, you would like to know how much will the output change provided I turn a few knobs or I change a few parameters. So, in such cases, you basically need to know how one vector changes with respect to another vector, okay, or another some other parameter. So, a standard way of how we measure how one quantity changes with respect to another, of course, is the partial derivative. Okay, if you have two scalars, you know very well how to change, you know, or find out how one function changes with respect to a parameter x. So, all this is of course a subset of calculus. Now, we are going to slightly extend this idea into matrix calculus, which basically means how does one vector change with respect to another vector and how do you parameterize this and what are some of the basic relations. This is going to be a very initial or preliminary class. I am going to use only some of the relations that we will require in terms of machine learning. Of course, much more advanced material exists. As I said before in the introduction, it's useful to understand these, but in case you do want to go ahead with the course even without understanding this material, that is fine. You will be able to extract 90% of the information of this course anyway. Okay. Of course, in comparison to the relations that I am showing, there are many more advanced relations which do exist. A good source is the one that I have flashed on the screen right now, and there are sources within this website also which go into greater detail. So, let us look at one simple case. We will assume, of course, that you know how to differentiate one scalar with respect to another, but let us say you have a scalar with respect to a vector or vector with respect to a scalar in this case. This is del A vector with respect to x. Remember, this is a vector and this is a scalar. So, if you differentiate a vector with respect to a scalar, the result that you get is a vector. Okay. So, for example, let us say A vector is x square, x cube, x to the power 5, and x is a scalar. So, del A vector del x also has three components, which is going to be 2x, 3x square, and phi x to the power 4, which is what is represented here. The ith component of this vector is simply del a I del x. Okay. So, I hope this portion is clear. You could have the reverse case where you have a scalar differentiated with respect to a vector. So, del x del a I, an example would be something like so this is a scalar function. It takes three inputs x, y, z. We could call this x vector, or if you are interested, we can even call this x1, x2, x3 square. Okay. And then del f with respect to del x vector, this is of course what we call the gradient. This is now a vector. Okay. The first component is going to be del f del x 1, the second component is going to be del f del x 2, third component is going to be del f del x 3. I will put a transpose here because this is right now a row vector, you can turn it into a column vector. So, del f del x 1 is x 2 x 3 square, x 1 x 3 square, 2 x 1 x 2 x 3. Okay. So, this is differentiation of a scalar with respect to a vector. Okay. So, a gradient is a prototypical example of some such thing, it also results in a vector. Now, let us look at a slightly more involved case, the differentiation of one vector with respect to another vector. Where does it occur physically? I mean, of course, in machine learning we might not necessarily look at you know, physical examples, but just for physical intuition, let us say you have velocity in a particular room of the air and you want to differentiate it with respect to the position. So, in each point, at each point you can have x velocity, y velocity, z velocity changing with respect to the location x, y, z. So, as I move to a different point, all three components will change. So, this is a vector differentiated with respect to another vector, and what it results in is a matrix or a what we call a second order tensor. It is actually a fairly simple relationship, ith component of I differentiated with respect to jth component of B. Okay. So, for example, if you have A is the vector A1, A2 and B is the vector B1, B2, then del A vector by del B vector and del A2 with respect to del B2. So, this is a matrix and that is what is written here, del A del B I j is equal to del A I del B j. Okay. This relation we will actually be using you know, a little bit more. So, this is differentiation of a dot product with respect to x. Of course, this is actually speaking, so let us say this is a vector and this is a vector. The product is of course going to be a scalar. So, this is a special case of the previous example we had seen, but unlike the previous case an x is actually occurring here. Okay. So, remember x dot A can be written as x transpose A, where x is a vector, you transpose the matrix, a row matrix multiplied by a column matrix. It can also be written as A transpose x, both are the same because the product is actually a scalar, and you can show that del x of x dot A is equal to A vector. Okay. So, I will just quickly show it to you in a special case, you can also show this in general. So, let us say x vector is x 1, x 2, x 3 and A vector is A 1, A 2, A 3. So, this means x dot A as you know is A 1 x 1 plus A 2 x 2 plus A 3 x 3. Remember, this is a sum and now we have a scalar. Now, del x vector of x dot A is going to be del x 1 of x dot A, as we saw on the previous slide, del x 2 x dot A and del x 3 x dot A. Now, you can immediately see del x 1 of this is A 1, del x 2 of this is A 2. So, this is A vector. Okay. So, hence you can prove this. I have shown this in the 3-dimensional case. You can of course, show this in n dimensions quite easily. Now, let us come to the next level of evolution, which is matrices with respect to vectors. So, suppose you have product of two matrices A, B, and you are differentiating it with respect to a vector x, okay, it could be a vector or a scalar. In either case, the relationship that is shown here actually holds. Del A del x times b, so this is the equivalent of chain rule. Okay. Remember that the order A B never changes. So, this is del A del x times B. Do not write this as, you know, del A del x times B plus, you know, del B del x times A. So, this does not work because matrix product in general does not commute. So, the chain rule, you have to be careful about the order of the matrices being used. And this the result, the relation I am showing now, or the result I am showing now, is important along with the dot product rule that I showed a little bit below. Remember that, let us say A is an n cross n matrix, then x transpose A n is actually a scalar, x transpose A x is called a the quadratic or a quadratic form. You can review your linear algebra lectures where this was discussed. So, x transpose A x is a quadratic form. This is all put together a scalar. Why? Because this is n cross n, this is n cross 1, and this is 1 cross n. So, if you multiply all of them, you will get 1 cross 1. So, you will see natural places where this tends to occur. Now, what happens is the derivative of this with respect to x. Remember, derivative of scalar with respect to a vector also has to be a vector, and indeed it is a vector. So, this is n cross n, n cross n, n cross 1. So, the result actually is a n cross 1 vector. Okay. Scalar with respect to vector is actually a vector. Okay. So, the proof of this, we are not going to do this. So, the proof is actually slightly involved. I will show you a quick verification just like with the dot product case on the next slide. A useful relationship is that in case you have a matrix which is symmetric, so symmetric A means A is equal to A transpose. So, this relation simply becomes 2 AX, and it looks remarkably like our scalar formula, which is d by dx of, let us say, some alpha x square is equal to 2 alpha x. Of course, this is for scalar x. Here you have to be a little bit careful. This is x transpose Ax, and you get 2 times Ax for symmetric A. So, let us look at the quadratic form and look at a quick verification. So, we look at the verification for a 2 by 2 case. So, let us assume A is of the form A11, A12, A21, A22. Of course, x transpose will be x1, x2, and x can be written as x1, x2. Recall that x transpose Ax is essentially summation over I and j of all products of the form Aij, Xi, Xj. You can of course multiply it out using the usual matrix multiplication and find this. But if you do this, so you will get A11 x1 square plus A12 x1 x2 plus A21 x2 x1 plus A22 x2 square. Okay. So, now if I have to find out del x vector of this, so let us call this q. So, as before, this is del q del x 1 del q del x 2. Okay. So, we know del q del x 1 is equal to 2 a 11 x 1 plus x 2 times a 12 plus a 21. Okay. Similarly, del q del x 2 is equal to this term does not contribute anything, you get x 1 times a 1 2 plus a 2 1 plus 2 a 2 2 x 2. So, now this can be written as please notice this 2 a 1 1 a 1 2 plus a 2 1 again a 1 2 plus a 2 1 2 a 2 2 times x 1 x 2. This matrix of course is A plus A transpose. Okay. So, this you can quickly see if you do A transpose it is going to be A 1 2 A 2 1, if you add the 2 you are going to get this. So, this is A plus A transpose times X. Okay. So, you have verified these relationships. So, we will be using these relationships off and on during the rest of the course. Thank you.